Please rise. Thank you. You may be seated. Well, on behalf of the family, let me thank you so much for attending today's service. And on behalf of our church, let me welcome you to Calvary Baptist. It was 1 week ago today that most of us got word that our friend Mike Lane had gone home to be with the Lord. And I think I can probably speak for the majority of us when I say that this news came as a shock. Our hearts went out to Debbie and the family. Our prayers went up for the churches in Honduras. And on our side of heaven, this seemed like such a tragedy. A good man cut down in the prime of his life, a great missionary, no longer able to go and tell. That's on our side of heaven. But ladies and gentlemen, I believe on God's side of heaven, this was anything but a tragedy. This was a promotion. This was a divine appointment. And our friend Mike Lane closed his eyes on Monday, there in his home, there in his bed, there in the country that he loved, and he opened his eyes to see the face of Jesus Christ. So we've gathered here today to honor Mike Lane, husband, father, grandfather, missionary. But I think Mike would probably be upset with us if we didn't say this. We're here to honor Mike, but above all, we're here to honor Mike's Savior, Jesus Christ. And our prayer is today that he gets great glory from this service. Thank you for being here today.
I want to invite you all to stand, and we're going to sing this hymn together, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Sing it, what a friend. And what a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. And what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. And all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials? And have we trials and temptation? Is there trouble anywhere? And we should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. And are we weak and heavy laden, cumbered with the load of care? Precious Savior, still our rest. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee? Take it to the Lord in prayer. And in his arms he'll take and shield thee. Now we'll find a solace there.
You may be seated.
I join Pastor Lovelace in the reality of the shock of the news of Mike's passing. But I was equally honored when Debbie asked Brandon and Chrissy to get hold of me and ask if I could lead in prayer and share a few personal memories that I have of Mike. My prayer today is for four things. One, that Mike would be honored. His is a life well lived. His is an example, a legacy for any young child of God to emulate and follow. My prayer is that the family would be comforted. All the faith in the world, and this family has faith, but it doesn't remove the heartache and the pain associated with the separation that death brings. My prayers for the family. My prayers for God to be glorified, that through the life and the ministry of Mike, that God would be exalted and magnified. That was his desire, Mike's desire. And then the numerous friends, many lifelong friends. I pray that you will be encouraged today through this memorial service. My relationship with Mike is unique. We had a lifelong relationship that lasted from nursery all the way to his passing. Our lives followed a very similar path. Many times people would mistake me and Mike. And we were very similar. We grew up in the same church, same nursery, same preschool, same elementary, same junior high when they called it junior high, and same high school. Attended the same college, Arlington Baptist College. Went to the same youth camp, Silver State Youth Camp. Heard some of the same preachers. Dr. Odom was both of our heroes. Ronnie and Pat Keith made a huge impact on both of our lives. We both had the unique privilege of working for Brother Dunn in Central Baptist Church in Deer Park. Mrs. O was a mentor and a purveyor of wisdom, and we held her in high esteem. Mike went on after leaving Deer Park there, Central Baptist in Deer Park, went on to do a great work in Tacoma, Washington. He went from there to Honduras, where many great works were established there. I had the joy and the privilege of spending two-week tenures in Honduras. And Mike and I were not only lifelong friends, but we had a lot of the same desires and hobbies in life. We would spend about 8 days doing mission work, and then we would fly to a little island called Roatan and scuba dive over there, see an entirely different perspective of God's creative genius. And those are memories that are sweet and precious in my life. Not only that, but Mike not only knew how to work hard for the Lord, he knew how to have fun in life, whether it was riding motorcycles or dune buggies. We spent many a Saturday riding dune buggies and getting muddy and dirty, and he knew how to have fun. And I like that about Mike. Mike was one of the few that I know that never wavered from his faith, from elementary all the way up to the day God called him home. I never knew his faith to waver. And I never knew his life not to reflect Jesus Christ. You just can't say that about very many people. You look through the scripture and they all have their dark chapters in their life. I can't say that about Mike. He's like Joseph was in scripture. He was like Daniel was in scripture. He never had his trip to Egypt that left a stain and a scar. Mike was a man that I greatly admired, simply because of his faith and his love for Jesus, his dedication to God's Word. He and I shared many of those same beliefs. When I think about Mike's life, I thought about our Lord's intercessory prayer in John 17. And in John 17, our Lord gave a sort of a prayer report of his earthly ministry. And throughout those 26 verses in John 17, our Lord said, "I have done this, I have done this." And as I examined those 10 things that the Lord said, "I have done," if you have any King James Bible, every time you read the words "I have," circle it. And it tells you something that Jesus did. And I look at Mike's life, and Mike did those same 10 things. He glorified the Father. He finished his work. He manifested the name of God the Father and God the Son. He gave them the Word of God to those who he taught. He prayed for them. He kept them. He spoke the things of God to them. He sent them into the world. Mike was a discipleship. He was a disciple maker. And many are in the ministry serving God, just like he did. he declared unto them the name of Jesus. And what Mike did in his life is the same thing that Jesus did in his ministry. And so when you look at the life of Mike Lane, you see a life that's patterned after the Lord Jesus. You know, when Mike went to bed Sunday night, David kissed him and said, "I love you, Mike." The next face he saw was his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That's not a bad way to go, guys. Be kissed by your life mate and then welcomed by your Lord and Savior. And that's the life of Mike. We'll miss him on earth, but I believe the separation is only temporary and very short. Heavenly Father, we bow before you today. And God, it's with praise and adoration that we come into your presence, celebrating the life and the legacy of a great man of God, a good husband, a tremendous father, a friend, and an example for all to emulate. God, thank you for his life. God, may he be honored in this service today for living that life. It was a choice he made. God, I ask and pray also that you would bring comfort to his family. I pray for Debbie, Christy and their families, Brandon, their families, Mike's sisters and their families, Debbie's family. God, I just pray that your comfort, your hope, your presence would encourage them today. God, I pray that you would be glorified. How miserable this hour would be were it not for the hope that we have in Christ Jesus. God, thank you that you rose from the grave and we have hope because of that. And Lord, I ask and pray for the multitude of friends that are gathered to hear, to celebrate his life and to honor his memory. I pray they would leave here encouraged, strengthened, challenged to live their lives to a greater extent for the glory of the Lord Jesus. Father, for these things we'll give you praise, honor, and glory. And thanksgiving. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, the family's asked me to read this morning what is perhaps the most beloved psalm of all time, the 23rd Psalm. And David said, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." James Michael Lane, we knew him as Mike, was born in the state of Texas to Jim and Debbie Lane on August 27, 1952. He met his wife Debbie in their home church, Calvary Baptist here, and they were married on June 3, 1972. The Lanes attended Arlington Baptist College Bible Baptist Seminary, and after graduating, Brother Lane served on staff for 5 years as the music and youth minister at Central Baptist Church in Deer Park, Texas, with Brother Charles Dunn. They then moved back to serve 1 year here at Calvary, where Brother Lane became the visitation minister and junior high teacher, and he worked in the printing ministry as well. In 1980, the Lanes followed God's call and moved to the mission field of the Great Pacific Northwest, where Brother Lane became the pastor of Faith Baptist Church in Tacoma, Washington. During his 14 years of ministry at Faith, Pastor Lane was able to see many people saved, many people baptized. And during that time, they started a Christian school, began supporting 50 missionary families around the globe, and sent two missionary families from the church. And the church grew in its properties as well as in its membership. After serving in the United States for 20 years, Mike and Debbie were called to the mission field of Honduras, Central America, where they've served as missionaries since 1994. And through God's leading, they had a part in starting and establishing 11 churches, witnessed in over 25 communities, and trained leadership in indigenous local Baptist churches. Mike had a passion for forestry, hunting, fishing, guns, and anything he could do to be outside with nature. I think we'd all agree, however, his greatest passion, and it was very clear, was Jesus Christ. His greatest passion was the local church. His greatest passion was helping bring people to Christian faith, then Christian maturity. Mike is survived by his parents, Jim and Dovey Lane, two sisters, Karen Wheeler and Donna Talley, his wife of 43 years, Debbie, his daughter and son-in-law, Christy and Cosman Holhosveda, his son and daughter-in-law, Brandon and Kathy Lane, seven grandchildren, Esther, Hannah, Abigail, Josiah, Dakota, Michaela, and Braden, and numerous aunts, uncles, nieces, nephews, and as we see today, many, many friends. At this time, we've got several folks that are going to come and give testimony, give a few words about Mike and what he meant to them. And first of all, Mike's son, Brandon.
As he mentioned, my name is Brandon Lane. For those who do not know me, I'm Mike's oldest son, or youngest son, and I'm the only son. And I had the privilege of having a father like Mike Lane. On behalf of the family, I'd like to extend a huge thank you. First and foremost, to the Lord Jesus Christ. I know some of you have gone through very similar situations like this, and you can testify of God's grace. You know, it's kind of redundant to say that we don't deserve it, because that's exactly what grace is. It's just receiving something we don't deserve. And God has been so good all the time. And so our thanks to God for just how He has worked even among all the details. If you've had a chance to talk to my mom, just there's so many details trying to get my dad from Honduras to here. We just have seen God open up doors and wrap us in His love and comfort and grace that we needed so desperately in a time like this. Also like to thank the family and friends. Turn out like this. It speaks for itself. Thank you so much. You know, we've said it before, and I'm sure you've heard it. I don't know how people who don't know the Lord and don't have a good Christian home, how they make it in a time like this. I'm sure we've all met people and our hearts go out to them, and they just hardly have any friends, much less family. They have to try to survive through this. But with God's grace, His presence, has already been mentioned, the peace that passes all understanding. It's in times like this that the Word of God really comes to light in certain areas, in certain statements. It passes all understanding. And then friends that have been surrounding my mom, our families, with love, not just love, not just encouraging words, but gifts and flowers and trying to help her out financially, just all of these things. So we just wanted to extend our thanks out to not just family, but all the close friends and the history that they have. Well, Just a couple of things I'd say about my dad. Number one, he was a godly man. I remember even from a young child remembering my dad spend hours in this brown recliner reading his Bible. For hours. He had a certain way of sitting too, a couple of different ways. He'd either kick one leg up underneath the other and sit there. And if anyone has seen him read, he'd rest his fist up underneath his chin and sit there and read like that for hours. He loved the Word of God. He loved the Lord. And his life was evident in striving to seek God's will in his life and to please him. My dad was a passionate man. You ever have met my dad? You know my dad. You know he's passionate. He's passionate. Whatever he's involved in, he's given his heart to. His last message, my mom shared with us the Sunday before he passed away. He had had another message prepared, but God had kind of directed him elsewhere. And he didn't have any notes for what God laid on his heart. I appreciate the fact that he was led of the Spirit of God. But God had given him a message to preach, knowing that he was going to take him the next morning. And there was a message that was so vital to that church there in Honduras. And as God filled him with his Spirit and gave him the words to preach, he preached to a little church that it's time to grow up. He said, I can't carry you any longer, is what he told them. He said, some of you are still sucking on your thumbs. If you also know my dad is pretty straightforward too. To speak his mind. And he just admonished them and encouraged them to start walking with God from their own 2 feet. They have to wake up. They have to desire to know him. They have to walk by faith. The Bible makes very clear in Romans that Hebrews that without faith it's impossible to please God. And the only way for our faith to grow is from the Word of God. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And he just admonished them that they would walk with God themselves. And he talked of different works that needed to be done and ministries that still needed to go on and still needed to grow. And he said, I can't do this myself. You need to grow up. And God put that on his heart, knowing that his death was going to solidify that message. So, with everyone here, I'd also ask you to pray for the continued work, because that was my dad's heart's desire. That those people would walk with God, that the ministry that God used through my dad to start there in Honduras would continue on and continue to grow. As it was already mentioned, he loved the outdoors. My dad was always reading nature books and always eating everything. We would step on it. He would pick it up and cook it up. I'm serious. I don't know how many times I walked out of our church in Tacoma. I remember one time specifically. I walked out and he was standing in the neighbor's yard by their pine tree, picking needles off, eating them. And I'm just standing there. And you know, there's some children that say my parents are an embarrassment. That's not my case. My parents are not an embarrassment to me. But my dad on purpose embarrassed me on purpose. He did do that. He's picking plants up and cooking them up. I remember multiple times, we'd just pull over on the side of the road, and he'd go, you know what that was? That was red sorrel back there. And I'm like, I don't even know what that is, Dad. And that's a plant. You can cook that up. This is highly poisonous, but if you cook this at this degree, you won't die. And I'm like, should we be doing this? I mean, is this really necessary? Well, my dad would. He's grabbing cattails out of the, you know, the ditch and cooking them up and putting butter over them. He's like, you got to try this, son. I'm like, sandwich is fine with me, and there's no problem with that. My sister was the one that was ready and willing to try everything my dad offered. Me, not so much. My dad loved the outdoors. He really did. He felt at home in nature and in the outdoors and loved that. And he endeavored to teach us how to survive and so forth. My dad was also fun. You know my dad. My dad loved to laugh. My family, we would have movie nights, and the thing that we would want to pick is a comedy, and it was only if my dad was going to be there, because we would laugh at my dad laughing, and he would laugh so hard he'd start crying. I was reminiscing. We had a privilege of going to Africa with my dad and a couple other men, and he came in, and there was this chair, and the legs were kind of back legs were kind of kicked in the way it was made, and men were sitting around just in the living room, and he came out and sat down and went to lean back in the chair just to kind of kick it back, and the balance was already off. And so it just looked like he walked in, sat in the chair, and flipped over backwards immediately. You know, we didn't laugh. We were just like, what were you doing? What are you doing? You know, and before the chair hit the ground, he was already in you know, abrupt laughter. So by the time he hit and rolled backwards, he was crying because he was laughing so hard. It was just, that was my dad. He was always pulling practical jokes on me. He'd get rubber cement and put it on his finger, and he'd smear it on my arm after looking like he was picking his nose. And I'm, Dad, what are you doing? You know, and he just, if he could get a laugh out of you, he'd do it. It said sometimes he'd embarrass me. I remember at camp, I'd be talking to a pretty girl, and he'd just come up, and he'd stand there. It was already took enough nerves to talk to a pretty girl. And he'd make it awkward, you know. He'd walk up and just look at both of us. How are you guys doing? I'm just mortified, you know. And he'd go, son, hold on. And he'd lick his thumb and wipe down my eyebrow, smooth it out. Dad, knock it off, you know. And this girl, you know. He'd go, are you hungry? I'm like, not right now. And he'd reach in his pocket and pull out a roll that he had saved from lunch or something, you know, wrapped up in a napkin. I got an extra biscuit for you. I'm like, Dad, not now. You know, she'd finally walk up. We'll talk later. And he, Dad, you embarrass me. I'll take that biscuit now, though. I think I got a corn cob in here, too. You know, I mean, my dad was unselfish, too. I'll say that. He's so giving, so loving. So unselfish. My memory of my dad around mealtime, he was always concerned that I was eating enough. Always. He'd never finish his meal if he thought I wanted more. Son, you want more? Here, finish this. I don't want it. No, I'm full. I'm full, son. I don't need any more. He's just so giving. His life reflected his walk with God. His unselfish spirit, his pioneer spirit. My dad was a trailblazer. I kind of think of him that way. Blazing a trail where there was none, so those who were coming behind could follow in his footsteps. So proud of my father. Not every son can say that. Not every son has a testimony of his father investing in him. He told me, son, if anything, I want you to love and know God's word. That's what he told me. It was a message that impacted me. One time he told me he had no idea it really impacted me. He had heard it from Brother Larry Brundage when he was a young man. Brother Brundage told him, when God opens the door, you walk through that door. Because God may close that door and you may never get an opportunity like that again. My father said that advice helped direct his life. Because if you knew my dad when he was younger, he was shy. And he told me that when I was a young man. He didn't even tell me where it was from. He might have. But he told me the same advice. And I'll tell you, that same advice directed my life, because there were so many times the door would open up and I'd be scared to death. But that thought would come back, what if God closes this door? I may never get a chance again. By God's grace and his goodness, we are where we are today. My dad was my hero. I love my dad dearly. And I thank everyone here also for loving my dad, loving my family. And we do, as a family, covet your prayers. Because
I'd like to begin by reading something on behalf of my wife. It's a tribute she wrote for her father. Being the daughter of a preacher for 14 years and then the daughter of a missionary for 22 years has had its ups and downs, but with a true heart, I can say what a joy it's been. How very blessed I am to be the daughter of Mike Lane. I reap the love and prayers that surrounds me today because of what he sowed in the past. The amount of time that Dad poured into people around him and his servant heart really influenced me and gave me a concrete example of how to serve and to think of others before myself. By looking around this auditorium, I can see all the people he has touched. And there are so many others that would have been here if they could. My dad loved people. He loved their souls. He gave his energy, his time, his life for them. Sometimes I would get a little upset with Dad because I wanted more of him and his time. But I realized that he would check in on me and make sure that I was doing well in body, soul, and spirit, and that I was well taken care of. When he knew I was well, he would then run back to those needing saving, encouragement, care, direction, or help of any kind. That's what he did. That's who he was. He was a rescuer, a hero. Hero. I remember him running to his parents' house to help them with whatever they needed help with. Then he would run to help nephews to direct, encourage, and disciple them. Then he would run to the next person in need. He was very concerned with people's heart and soul and that it was right with God, moving on to the next weary, hurting, wayward soul. He loved fellowship with believers. His jolly disposition, the twinkle in his eye when he was about to say something funny, his contagious laugh is something I or anybody for that matter will ever forget. It is so etched in my mind and so vivid that I can't help but smile when I think about it. He would sit me on his knee and call me his little dear, no matter how big I got. He would take walks with me to teach me what plants and weeds are edible so that if I ever got lost in the woods, I could survive. He worried about my safety, so he taught me how to defend myself. He made sure I knew how to shoot guns with accuracy. And she is good. He raised me to be tough and endure hardships and to never give up, never to quit. All these things were great, and he equipped me well for the life I live now. But most importantly, he taught me to love our God and Savior with all my heart, all my soul, and all my strength. And he did that best. Brendan and I are living proof of that, and that he ruled his home well. God is gracious and full of mercy towards our family during this time of grief. His mercies have been renewed to us each morning. Yep. His love overwhelming, his arms tightly surrounding us as the mountains surround Jerusalem. We feel his presence. We know he is here with us, and he will continue to be the rest of our days.
God comforted me last Thursday with a verse from Psalm 31, verse 24. It says, "Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart, all you that hope in the Lord." Although we grieve our loss and our pain is deep because we loved him deeply, we are at the same time rejoicing for him and having the hope of seeing him soon. Our prayer is that through Dad's death, others would rise up to the call, be inspired and encouraged to never give up or quit the race set before them, and to love God with all their heart, soul, and strength, with a passion that's hot and will never dim until we are called home. We love you all and thank you for your effort in being here to celebrate my dad's life. Amen. There isn't much that I can say that Brandon didn't touch on, but the way I met this man was through the fact that we loved the same woman. Now, don't take this wrong exit with that thought. He loved her as a father. I come to love her as a wife. And I was glad to know the passion that he loved her with, because she was protected. And thus it took a lot of passion for me to get her from him. And I did.
That's right.
I learned a lot from him. We had great talks. And we had so much in common about survival. All the stuff that was already mentioned. I loved the most when we started a tradition in our family that for every Thanksgiving he would come over, and him and mom would be there, and we would just have the best of time. But I loved the stuff that he would clean that turkey so good, and I didn't have to take care of it. I do want to close by reading a couple of verses. I wrote in my Bible, "Dad Lane encouraged me today, February 4th, 2004, out of this psalm." I'm going to read these verses to you. Psalm 42, verse 11. "Why art thou cast down, O my soul? And why art thou disquieted within me? Hope thou in God, for I shall yet praise him, who is the health of my countenance and my God." And we will be healed by him. Another one is verse 3 and 4 out of Psalm 43. "Oh, send out thy light and thy truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me unto thy holy hill and to thy tabernacles. Then will I go unto the altar of God, and God my exceeding joy, yea, upon the harp will I praise thee, O God, my God." I am convinced God was his exceeding joy, and I've learned from him to do that. He would tell me, "You know, you don't have a harp, but go play the piano when you're down." And I've done that at times. And I love him more for it. Thank you.
Wondering who that Indian is running all over the place. I would advise not to try to swallow gum before you're to speak a little bit. If you go by the insert here, you'll notice that it's quite a shock if you're looking at Donna Talley. My name is Mark Wesley. I pastor the Bible Baptist Church in Durant, Oklahoma. We supported Brother Mike and Miss Debbie. Brother Mike was one of the greatest missionaries I've known. Hardworking, loved God, and was always an encouragement to me. Somehow or another, he could sense the hard times of being a pastor, and he would come to our church, and he would just have the right words to say. And he was a blessing. Our church loved him. And Miss Debbie, I want to say we're going to continue to support you till you get on your feet and God leads you and directs you in his will. I am here today to read as a member of the family. There are some words that I'm going to read that the family were not able to read because of their loss and were worried they would not be able to get through it. So they asked me to read these things and memories, incidents, and things that had familiarity as they grew up. For a lot of us, these things won't necessarily mean anything in particular. But when you see the family grin and you see the family laugh and look over at one another, you'll know it meant something to them. Mike's parents, Brother Jim and Miss Dovey, we love you. And this is a great honor. And I'm honored to be able to stand in this place to read these words that will bring back, I hope, some blessed memories and some times of laughter. Mr. and Mrs. Lane, his sisters, Karen and Donna, have asked me to share a few words from their hearts about Mike. He was always a good boy growing up and never did cause any trouble or grief for his parents. That right there is a great testimony. From an early age, Mike was a hard worker. His first job was delivering papers on his bicycle. He never was idle. He never sat down. He was always busy doing something. And for that, his parents can be very proud and are proud of his accomplishments. Last week, Mike had a long conversation with his mother and father. He told them, his mom, about the recent projects that they'd been working on in Honduras and how that they were able to finally complete them. And then he was able to talk to his dad, and he got his dad somehow or another to reminisce about his young days, how he plowed with horses and mules when he was a young boy. Mike loved family history. And he would ask his parents and grandparents every time they got together about how their life was when they were young. It was a unique conversation. And it was the last time that they were to speak with their son. When Mike was growing up, he managed to turn their residential backyard into a little farm where he raised chickens, turkeys, quail, ducks, and pigeons. His interests included reading, as we've already heard about, hunting, fishing, camping, collecting guns, and practicing survival skills. He loved dogs and enjoyed coon hunting in Atchley, Oklahoma, with an old-timer named Jewel Scoggins. Mike built a hut in the woods where his grandparents owned land out of cedar and stacked them together like a teepee. I wonder where the Indians were. And every chance he got, he would spend the night in the woods. His mom loved to cook for him. And as any young son would say here today, he loved to eat his mama's cooking. She'll always fix him black-eyed peas and fried okra. He loved fried potatoes. Around where we live, it's fried taters. And always wanted hot sauce with his meals, and he would take every opportunity that he could to challenge others as to who could eat the hottest pepper. He was always building things. One time he made a rowboat out of scratch and used Donna as a guinea pig to see if it would float in their grandparents' pond. He built a go-kart from an old lawnmower and raced up and down the streets of Ballaway. When he was older, he loved to ride dune buggies and motorcycles. He loved music. He loved to sing from an early age and would practice using his sister's hairbrush as a microphone. Later on, he would have friends over his parents' house, and they would play guitars and the banjo and sing. Every time he and Debbie would come to our church, my daughters and I sing, and he was always so kind and complimentary, tender, compassionate. And I don't know if we didn't sing out a tune or couldn't hold a tune in a bucket, but he said, "You've got to sing." He loved singing, loved music. Mike had a great laugh and a beautiful smile. His family was looking forward to him returning to the States here in just a couple of weeks. Mike just celebrated his 63rd birthday on August the 27th. His sister Karen was able to talk to him and enjoyed a conversation about all that he had been doing lately, and he had promised her to bring some pictures back when they got together. She told him when he came home they would celebrate his birthday. Donna was planning a trip home to see him as well. His mom had picked out a birthday card out for him to give to him when he had got back to the house. It was a fitting card, she thought, because it said, quote, "You're a special son. You'll never know how much it means to have you for a son, or what a warm ray of sunshine your affection is in the lives of those who love you so," end quote. And then she must have written somewhere in the card, "You're the kind of son all parents wish for, but only the luckiest ones have. Happy birthday. Love, Mom and Dad." The Word of God says in Matthew chapter 25 and verse 21, "His Lord said unto him, Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord." Mike started out hunting squirrels and ended up hunting exotic animals. As a boy, he fished from an old tank and had the opportunity as he grew up to fish for salmon in Canada and Alaska. As a boy, he built chicken pens in the backyard. And glory to God, he went on to build churches in Honduras. Amen. All of these characteristics of Mike's life molded him, prepared him for what God had in store for him in fulfilling his will. His mother and his father dedicated him to the Lord when he was young, and Mike chose to follow that path all the days of his life. He loved to laugh. He loved to cut up with young people in his youth department. He loved to sing specials. He loved to lead the singing. Most of all, he loved to preach the gospel,
yes,
and to win souls for the Lord Jesus Christ. Mike was a soul winner, not only in Honduras, But on the streets of Grand Prairie and the streets of Durant, Oklahoma, wherever he was a soul winner.
Yes.
He loved to serve God, and in turn, God blessed him with the very life that he loved with all his heart. A life full of adventure in the outdoors with the people that he loved. A doctor had just examined a patient who was dying. And as he got up to leave the room, he put his hand on the door handle, and the patient said, "Doctor," and he turned back and they met eyes. He said, "Doctor, I'm afraid to die. Tell me what's it like. What's it like on the other side?" And the doctor looked at him, searching, hoping for words to come. And he said, "I don't know. I don't know what it's like to die." And the patient said, "But doctor, you're a Christian. You're supposed to know those things." And about that time, there was a scratch and there was a whining behind the door, insomuch that he opened the door because it was a distraction. And inside that door came a little puppy and ran and jumped up into the doctor's arms and just began to do like little puppies do, licked him all over. And about that time, the doctor turned to the patient and said, "Did you see this little puppy?" He said, "He was on the other side. He didn't know what was over here. He didn't know what was inside. He's never been in this room before. But as he opened the door, he saw his master." And I can tell you today, we don't know what's on the other side. As it's already been said, we grieve and we weep in one eye and rejoice with the other. But thank God Almighty, when they opened up that door, he was in his master's hands. Well done, Mike. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord.
Everybody, it's an honor for me to be here, standing at this pulpit at this time. My name is Andy Cote, and I'm a church planner in Las Vegas. We have a three-year-old church that I'm pastoring out there. But one of the amazing things about my life is that I got to live with Mike and Debbie Lane in Honduras there for almost 8 months. I was living with him on the mission field as a missionary intern and got to go down there and run all over the hills with him, do everything he did. I was his sidekick down there in Central America as he was working, and I got to learn from him. He taught me a lot of things. He taught me so many things, and as I've heard people talk about him, the memories are coming back. And so I pray that as I get to talk a little bit about him, that you'll get to think of him some more. Remember him some more, and through the eyes of a young missionary intern, be able to remember him. I want to read to you something that Mike wrote to me. This is a Bible that Mike and Debbie gave me when I was down there in Honduras. They gave it to me for Christmas, and I want to read to you the note that he wrote on the inside page to me, and this will just let you know how the heart he has for people, the way he was willing to invest in others, and someone like myself who was of no relation to him necessarily, but he treated me like a son when I was there in Honduras, and Debbie as well. And let me read to you what he wrote to me. "Dear Brother Andy, we hope this Bible will be as much of a blessing to your life and ministry as you have been to ours. Thank you for choosing to serve in Honduras. for your internship. We have seen lots of growth in your ability with the language and with the people. We hope you will reach many for Christ as you preach the glorious gospel of Christ. We will miss you, but go with our prayers and blessings on your marriage and ministry. You have excellent study habits, and I know this Bible will be of use to you. We will always have you in our memory, thoughts, prayers, and heart. Philippians 1, 3 through 7. Love in Christ, Mike and Debbie. And as I think of Mike and as I remember him, and like I said, being able to get up close and personal, living in the same house with them for almost 8 months there, I think of a few things that I remember Mike by. I think of how he loved fresh coffee. He was a coffee lover, that's for sure. I remember how he told me and others as well how that when he was real young, he had to make a decision for the Lord to leave off one particular friendship who was his best friend, his best buddy in the world as a little boy, and you know how important that is. And he had to say no to that friend, and he had to make a decision whether he was going to put his God first or his friend first. And we all know he chose his Lord.
Yes.
But that was one of the molding decisions in his life as he relayed his testimony to me. I think of the church that they planted down in Honduras, the one which was fairly close to the home where they lived. It was called Iglesia Bautista Nueva Esperanza. That's New Hope Baptist Church. And that name wasn't just by coincidence. That name was specifically chosen by him as a representation for what he was doing in that country and why he had gone there, to give the people new hope, to bring that hope that Jesus Christ offers all men, even if they live in Central America. I can remember when he taught me what it meant. You know, I was young and I was learning, and I remember asking him one day, we were driving in his green truck, his little Chevy that he had, and I can still remember sitting in the truck, and I asked him, Brother Mike, I don't understand what it means when the Bible says that some men preach Christ out of contention, and what does that mean? What is Paul trying to say that? And he went on to tell me, well, some people were just out there doing the ministry to kind of get at the Apostle Paul, and he just explained it to me in his southern draw and told me exactly what it meant. And I remember it to this day. I have it as a part of me, given to me by God through Mike Lane. That's Philippians chapter 1, verses 15 through 18. I can remember when he, as Brandon already mentioned, explained the meaning and the principle of being led by God and going through the doors that God opens unto us. That's found in Revelation chapter 3, verses 7 through 13. And he taught that principle to me, and I've tried to live by those principles that he's taught me. And to go through the doors, God opens the door, God opens the doors, and no man can shut them. And then there'll be a time when God will shut doors too. And he taught that to me. And every time I read those verses, I think of the man Mike Lane. I can think of how he cared for me and taught, was willing to invest in me. And I can remember a few things. As I've been sitting here, I thought of a couple things that I wanted to mention. I can remember one time we were running all over the hills of Honduras. Every Sunday morning we get up at 7, go up, drive 2 hours up into the hills and minister at one or two of the works up there, sometimes three, and then come back down. But we'd be up there, and he would always be talking about plants, of course. This is this plant, and that's that plant, and don't eat this, or this one you can't eat. And I can remember there was something that the Hondurans would do down there, kind of like a Honduran yeehaw type of a thing. And it was Ayi. I don't know if he ever told that to any of you in this room, but sometimes he would just get up the earth, just go, Ayi, when he was running around up there in the hills and shout that out. And he was just having fun and being adventurous and exploring. And I just, like I said, got to be his sidekick and help him out. I can remember one time he sent me out to do a few things. and he sent me out with his van. It was a blue Ford 15 passenger van down there. He sent me out, and it was raining, and boy, does it rain down there. And I ended up getting that bad boy stuck in the mud. Couldn't get it out. Of course, he knew right where I was and right where I should be. I didn't come back home in time. There was no way to call him. There was no way to let him know where I was or what I was doing. But he knew right where I was, right where I should be. I didn't come back in time. So next thing I know, he's pulling up in his vehicle right where I was. He found where I was, went and saved me. I was stuck in the mud. But then the next day, first thing, we got in his truck, went out there, and he didn't get that van out. Guess who got that van out? He brought all those tools. He brought everything that was needed, but he made me get the van out. He made me learn my lesson. He taught me just the way, like I said, he would, as if I were his own boy, and I'm thankful to God for that. I'm thankful for him, and I can remember one time when I got sick down there, and Debbie, she was in the States, and I had one of them, like, 24-hour flus type of thing, you know, and but it was just me and Mike there, and you know, a little bit awkward for him, a little bit awkward for me, you know, we're two supposedly full-grown men as far as what I would have thought, considered myself to be, but I was laid up in the bed there, sick and not feeling good, just trying to get some rest and some sleep. And Mike, he wouldn't let anything go that needed to be done, would he? So what he did, he came in and checked on me. I remember him coming in a couple times and just putting his hand on my forehead and checking on me and loving on me, making sure I was okay. And that's the way I remember Mike Lane. And so when I heard he passed away on Monday, I wrote a little something just to kind of commemorate his life and my memories of him specifically. I tried to incorporate that into just a short little type of a poem that I want to read for you here today. I hope that it'll be a blessing to you, and I hope that'll bring back some precious memories of him as I read it. I called it The Man, Mike Lane. Gone is the man, though his memory stays, who loved fresh coffee and the cowboy way. Gone is the man, but his friendship goes on, who said no to wrong friends and yes to his God. Gone is the man, but cherished still, who embraced God's call and gave up his own will. Gone is the man, but a hero is he, who brought men new hope, which made many men free. Gone is the man, though we still feel his love, who rejoiced in the gospel and the preaching thereof. Gone is the man, though he lives yet again, who entered the doors that were opened to him. Gone is the man, though his life still speaks, who did the Lord's work week after week. Gone is the man, but admired forever, who poured out his life as a sweet-smelling savor. Gone is the man, yet to our hearts still belongs, who went to the world, to the regions beyond. Thank you very much.
Shared with me the good news when I was just a boy. Lived out in front of me that the Lord is our true joy. You said the road's not always easy, but God is ever true. You said just share the good things that He has done for you. You became my hero of the faith, a soldier of the cross, preaching out. Jesus saves the lost. Now it's time to lay your armor down and pass the torch. You're a hero of the faith, soldier of the cross. I just got the news this morning that you had slipped away. It seemed my heart was broken. It couldn't end this way. But then I saw with spirit eyes the entrance you must have made. Running to the arms of Jesus, finally home to stay. With other heroes of the faith, soldiers of the cross, preaching out the grand old story, Jesus saves the lost. Cross. Even though you've laid your armor down and passed the torch, you are my hero of the faith, soldier of the cross.
Well, this really doesn't seem possible. I think we're all shocked with Mike's homegoing. I loved him a lot. I hadn't seen him in a long time. I have great memories of Mike and Debbie, Christy, Brandon. Matter of fact, he sounded like his daddy singing. Really did. I loved him a lot. I've had a number of people work with me in my 40-year ministry. Some memories I really don't want to remember. But this guy, I have some great memories. He was my brother in Christ, but he was just more than that. He came to Deer Park at only 21 years of age. Debbie was just about that, I think. And he led the music and learned the music in Sunday school in this church. And he led our music. He taught our young people, among many other responsibilities. And he led what we call the Happy Side Singers. That was our youth choir, and our church was fairly small at that time, wasn't real large. Mike was always faithful to do what I asked him to do and always did a great job. We were all proud of him. Did a great job. I think he was probably the first youth director that we had that literally carried over 100 young people, him and Debbie, to Colorado and to the youth conference, the World Baptist Youth Conference. And the competition was always enormous between this church and the church in Deer Park, and most of the time we won. And Mike was the leader during those days. He won a lot of people to Jesus. I appreciate all the pastors that Brother Jimmy and Brother Lovelace, the pastors, what they said about Mike Lane. And what can you say about a son? What more can you say? That doesn't always happen. But it happened with Mike Lane. And we're thrilled today. I just did a memorial service at my church for a gentleman that was a right-hand man to me for 15 years, a great man. Then I got the news. My wife told me that Brother Mike had gone home. He left the temporary for the eternal. That's what he did. And we're all temporary here. Everything temporary here. But we're going to the eternal. Never fade away. Never. Everything fades away here. But one day we'll be home. That's the promise. And so, you think about him going up there. He was only there with me 5 years. And I knew in the beginning that Brother Mike and Debbie, he had a great desire to go to the mission field. That was his focus. And I wouldn't hold him back for anything if that's what God called him to do. And that's what he did. So he went to Tacoma, Washington, worked there for a number of years and did a great job. But then the call was still there. Honduras, I think 20 years maybe or more. But he loved Jesus. Mike and I won a lot of souls to Christ. I've been privileged to have two men that work with me. Dr. Odom would be proud. And they were the best men that ever I could have asked for to work with me. Mike Lane and Jim Withers. Extremely loyal men, just wonderful servants of Jesus. And I just want to thank Debbie and Christy and Brandon and their family. How wonderful you are. How blessed you are. I know he had his faults, like I have my faults and you have your faults. But deep in his heart, there was that love for God and his family and other people. And we'll always remember that. So I thank you for inviting me to do this. I do this only on special occasions. I've taken a long rest after a long ministry. And sometimes it was like a roller coaster. But I'll tell you one thing, if I had my life to live over again, just like Brother Mike, I knew his heart, I'd say, let's go again. Let's go again. It's worth it all. And one of the brethren just said, I believe it was Brother Withers, the greatest day was when he saw Jesus. And he's now there forever. That's where his heart was, and I'm glad that you have given me the privilege of sharing just a little with you. Now then, I know we've had a good, lengthy, beautiful time of celebrating a man's life. And I'm sure that most of us would like to be somewhere else because we'll miss Mike. But we honor him, what he meant to our soul, our life, to so many people. And I'll tell you what, he crammed a lot of life into 62 years. I forgot that Mike's birthday was right next to mine. I loved him a lot. I loved him a lot. He was a great friend, just a beautiful human being. Oh, we had our little differences, everybody does. But we had great times together, and I'll always love Jim Withers. Everybody I meet, I tell them, there's hardly not a better person than Jim Withers. Him and Mike were two of a kind and grew up here at this place. Isn't that something? In this church. This church has a lot of productivity in it. I want to share something with you this evening. One verse of scripture. I'd like to read more of these verses, but because of time, I want to be conscious of that. In the 71st Psalm, there's a verse of scripture, and I'll just read this verse because that's where we're going to focus. In the 71st Psalm, the writer says in verse 14, "But I will hope continually and will yet praise thee more and more." And that's what I want to leave with you today in commemoration of Mike Lane's life, because I believe he lived this verse as well as all of us should live it if we belong to God. Hope and help for the hopeless. That's what this verse reminds you of. This is a psalm along with Psalm 70 about feeling hopeless and helpless. And sometimes we all feel that many times. And it's a psalm that's attributed by most to King David. And he was in the midst, as many of us are, in declining health and strength in his body, as the years have taken their toll upon him, and old age is approaching. Verses, the chapter 70 and 71, both of them deal with his feelings. It's sad feelings many times. But when he comes to this verse, verse 14, that's where I want to focus just for a few minutes. Just a few thoughts. He says, "But I will hope continually." In other words, with all the things he was going through and even what this service is all about, he said, "I'm going to hope, I will hope continually, and yet will yet praise thee more and more." In spite of all the enemies, in spite of all the things that were happening, in spite of death, I will hope. And hope is a promise from God and only from Him. So I want to give you three things from this verse that blesses my heart. And I thought about it as they called me, Brandon and Christy, and asked me to share a few words. Number one, you have a positive decision by this man, David. He said, "I will hope. I will hope." And that's a great decision to make in your life. Nail down the word hope. It is so important for survival, especially in the day and hour that you live in. All of our enemies that attack us, all of our enemies, many of them. But what a decision. He said, "I will." Here's a man that has come to a decision. He's made up his mind. He said, "I will hope." To hope, this is the right decision to make of all the decisions that we make. But to hope in the Lord. You know, many people make bad decisions in life. I've made them. You've made them. People make them. But to live your life, "I will hope." That's what kept Brother Mike going. That was his philosophy of life. "I will hope." If you don't have that, you have nothing. You have nothing. And many people ruin their lives because they make bad decisions. But Brother Mike had made that decision to put his hope in the Lord. of all the decisions we make in life, and we make a lot of them, but to hope. I will hope. You know what that means? And I'll get to the reason he had his hope in just a second. I will hope. You know why he had made this decision? And hope simply means it's not over. It's not over. And this is not over because of hope. That's why David said, I will hope. I will hope. What is life without real hope? But you see, when you look at this verse, when you look at David, his hope was not in fame. He was a famous man. His hope was not in money. His hope was not in fortune. His hope was not in power. His hope was not in prestige, but in God. Hope was in God. And there is no other hope. Now, if that was true for him, it's true for you and I. But it is true. You see, what is life without hope? There is presented in our society and has always been until Jesus comes. There's always been so much fake, shallow, meaningless hope today. It's still on the TV airways and the radios. A lot of fake. Jesus is barely mentioned. Barely mentioned. But none of what the world offers has any value. Has no value. Nothing. It's all fake. It's all meaningless. What can satisfy us today? What can give us happiness? I mean, honestly, we need to look in the mirror and be honest with ourselves. What can make us happy? What can give us happiness and satisfy us without hope? Do you realize the Bible from Genesis to Revelation is all about hope? You realize Christmas, which is coming up again, and they want to do away with that. But Christmas, true Christmas, is all about hope. Nothing else. I don't care about anything else. It's all about hope. And little David, when he went out to kill Goliath as a young man, he went out there with hope. That's what he did, because God was his hope. And that's how he was able to kill the enemy, the big enemy of God's people. That's why the old warrior Paul, as he lay in prison and he was awaiting execution, he could write in Philippians with a smile, rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Without hope in Jesus, there's hardly a reason to smile. But with Jesus, we can always smile. No matter how bad it gets, no matter how dark it gets, we can always smile. When Hannah went up into the temple in the Old Testament, asking for a child. She had no children. But year after year, she kept going because of hope. And that's the way we have to be. So you have a positive decision. Many of you have made that decision. Live your life on hope. Get up in the morning and live on hope. Because there's nothing else. But live on the right hope. Live on the right hope. That's who God is. You see, secondly, I want you to notice a persistent challenge here. He gives all of us a challenge. I will hope continually. Never give up on hope. Yes, we will miss our good friend. We will miss Brother Mike. No doubt about it. And for that, we're sad. For that, we weep. For that, we're lonely. But we live because of hope. It's a persistent challenge. Every day you live, you need hope. Period. You can get by without money, you can make it. You can get by without a lot of things, but hope is an essential. It's absolutely an essential. Remember Jesus. Remember Him. Real hope. The only real hope that we have. I started out, I wasn't much older than Mike Lane. I was only 28. I had the blessing to go to the seminary and sit under some great, great preachers. Dr. Odom was one of those. But I went to that city. My wife and I, who grew up in this church, she did. We got married almost immediately. I took a little church. And when they used to pray for me, I was only 24, and they would pray for me. They'd say, God bless our very, very young preacher. That's about the way they prayed. Then I went from there to Deer Park. Dr. Odom recommended me. And I wasn't much older than Brother Mike was. So we had to learn a lot together also. But every day, you face struggles. You face disappointments. You face discouragements. You face doubts. You face fears. When times get hard, remember Jesus. Don't forget Him. Remember Him. When tears come, remember Jesus. When disappointments is your bed partner, remember Jesus. Remember who He is. Remember His love. Remember His compassion. Remember His power. But the writer here is facing many enemies every day. Many challenges every day for you and I. That's why he says, I will settle it every day. I will hope continually. So many challenges face our lives. Perhaps you've come here today that there are things that are challenging your hope. But remember Jesus. Remember that continually. Keep that a part of your life every day, every night. Jesus can defeat any challenge you face. A constant, everyday thing to have hope. Isn't it a fact tonight, today, that the world does everything it can to try to destroy our hope? It does, every day. And they're still trying. Oh, we see it in the newspapers, television. The world tries to destroy the Christian's hope. But they can't do it. We need to always remember hope. Having hope. Without anything else, anything nearly can defeat you. Anything can take you down if you don't keep your hope. Anything. And can cause us to turn to false hopes. Many are living on a false hope today. But Jesus gave Himself as the true hope. As a Christian, God has put His signature. He has written His name upon us. We belong to Him. We're His. His name is literally upon us. His signature. With Jesus in your heart and the world, you aren't an accident or an incident, but you're God's gift to the world as His light. And look at the light that Mike Lane was, not only here in America, but in another country and around the world. You realize that we have young people here in this service. They now have their own families. They're here. They drove almost from Houston to here. And others, some I think from Alabama or somewhere, to be here because of this man, Mike Lane. They grew up in his youth department. Mike was not an accomplished musician when he came to that city. I mean, he could lead music pretty good, but he grew. And he became better and better and better. It's the same way with Brother Jimmy. Most people didn't realize that he led music, did just about anything. But you know, God put his signature upon us. And we're his. We don't have to be somebody else. We just be ourselves with God's signature upon us. We're important. We're a divine work of art signed by Jesus himself. A man had a football that was signed by so many professional football players. They were all quarterbacks. But there's nothing unique about the football. It might have been bought at a discount store. The signature on it made it unique. It was valuable. It was priceless and worth a lot of money. You know, our value as Christians, our uniqueness, is determined by God's signature on our life, by his name. There is no other name in heaven and on the earth like his name. There is none. My wife and I have been enormously blessed. The first 20 years, 15 or so, we sailed along pretty good. Mike was one of those, Brother Jimmy was. But then we began to have our difficulties, like everybody does. But we've been blessed. My son-in-law, who spent 18 years with the New York Yankees, I have a lot of paraphernalia that Andy has given me, a lot of it. And he signed it. He signed a lot of things for other people, some my relatives. But it's not worth anything. It's his signature. That's what makes it valuable. We're nothing without his signature. We're nothing. And Mike knew that. And it's hard for me to feel sorry for him because he was Jesus. And we're all going to be there soon. So let's not weep too much because nobody knows what tomorrow may bring. And Mike didn't, and you and I don't. But that's okay. We have his signature on our life, his name. That's why we can say, I will hope continually in him. You just don't ever give up hope. Every day you live, get up, say, I hope continually, I will. Nobody's going to take it from me. That's why I was able to survive, in a sense, for 40 years in one place. 40 years pastoring a church. You cannot believe how many people I run across that I know. And I have to look at them real carefully because I don't recognize them. And how they recognize me, I don't know, and yet it's because I stay so young. But they recognize me. But I'm going to tell you, when you have God's signature on your life, it makes a big difference. He puts his signature. You belong to him, nobody else. And he does that by grace through faith. Not of ourselves, but the gift of God. So the writer says, I will praise thee. The last thing I want to leave with you real quickly. A person who is reliable. A person who is reliable. You have a man that makes a positive decision here. And you have a persistent challenge. I will hope continually. Then you have the person who is reliable. The writer says, I will yet praise thee. All through those two Psalms, it's always about the Lord. It's always about him. I will praise thee more. And then he says more. More and more. Praise and hope go together. They're twins. The more you hope and praise, the more praise you hope. And that's what he's talking about. This is a verse about a reliable person, the one that you can always count on, always. One that you can believe in for hope. Job, the oldest book in the Bible, he never gave up hope. Joseph, who spent 20 years in prison, no telling, hadn't seen his family in a long, long time, but he never gave up hope. Never. And this is what the psalmist is talking about. You see, Job and Joseph, they were winners. Jesus Christ in our heart, that means nothing is impossible. That means anything. Death has been conquered. This is why he's talking about this. With him, nothing is impossible. His signature on our lives. I want to close with this simple illustration. We close with Noah, the account of Noah and the flood. Noah was in the ark 40 days, 40 nights. Can you imagine the flood coming upon the earth? Can you imagine the thoughts being human? What must have went through Noah's mind? 40 days, 40 nights. But then, suddenly, all of a sudden, 40 days, 40 nights, then all of a sudden, a dove returned to Noah and brought a leaf. Isn't that amazing? The Bible is perfect. Everything it says, God wanted it in there. And Noah, in that ark, a dove returned, and in its beak was a leaf. When the bird returned to Noah in the evening, fresh in the beak was a freshly plucked olive leaf. Genesis 8:1. And an olive leaf, God is speaking to all of us in a big way through this olive leaf. And I think we need to remember that. An olive leaf of all things. Noah would have been happy to have had the bird, but to have the olive leaf. This leaf was more than just foliage. This leaf was a promise. That's what it represented. The bird brought more than a piece of a tree. It brought hope. It brought hope. Hope is the olive leaf. The olive leaf. Without it, you have no hope, no promise. You have the flood, you have the hard times, you have the loneliness, you have the hopelessness, the doubts. Now it's over. It's going to be all right. That's what the olive leaf tells us. That's what it says to us today in this memorial service. It's over because of the olive leaf. Yes, Mike left the temporary. He left the temporary. But we live by hope. And the olive leaf assures us of that. Everything is hopeless in our world. But God said through the olive leaf, it's going to be all right because of hope. The shock of Mike's death was pretty tough. All of us who knew him, we loved him. And this crowd today shows that, what we thought about him and Debbie. The olive leaf represents a new life. That's what it represents. A new life that God gave Noah and the rest of them. New beginning. The flood is over. I still love you. I'm still for you. It's going to be okay. What if we didn't have that today? It's going to be okay. It's not over. There's a new life that God has promised us. That's the olive leaf. Jesus' death was a flood. I mean, wicked men had nailed him to a tree. Wicked men had crucified him. But then came warning. The flood. What a flood it was. Filthy humanity. Our sins nailing him to a tree. And the enemy saying, it's over. It's over. The flood. It's there. But then came morning. The women came and told the disciples, Jesus is alive. The flood is over. There's new life for all of those who will believe in Christ. There's a promise. The flood is over, and Jesus won, and we win. I want you to remember Mike as a winner. That's what he is. That's what every person in Christ, we're a winner. And I don't mean just words. I don't just like to hear somebody say, I'm a Christian. I want to see more than just words in a person's life. James said, faith without works is dead. Mike proved you got to have more than just words. And I'll tell you, all of his life, seemingly, from the time he came to our city, and when he left, went to Tacoma, and the rest of his life, him and Debbie, I really hated to see him leave. I really did. They could have stayed there forever. Same way with Brother Withers. But you know, I'm not God. It's not my business. You got to go where God calls you. And when I went, I had about 10 people, I think, or so. I thought everybody loved me. Time I got there, I'd already lost a family. So that's the way it is. You don't do it for people, you do it for Jesus, because we're winners in Christ. The disciples were sad. They were defeated. But then the news came of the olive leaf of hope. He's alive. I've seen him. That's what they said. We've seen him. He's alive. That means we can hope continually. Man, how important that is. More praise, more hope. Because he's given us an olive leaf. So, Brandon, you got a great heritage. Christy and Debbie, your wonderful husband. Good times, bad times, parents, loved ones. We've got an olive leaf. It's called hope. It's always with you. When you get discouraged and it's lonely, and it will be. Mike knew that. He knew that. But if I've got to go in life, if I've got to leave this place from the temporary to the eternal, let me go like Mike. That's the way to go. But we don't choose that. But the enemies surround us. They're all about us. I think we got people in Washington that would like to destroy our hope. They'd like to put us on false hopes. But there's only one hope, praise God. Jesus is our hope. He's our hope. He's our olive leaf. And death is not the end. We can't be defeated. Jesus is alive. And so is Brother Mike. Until we meet again, and I hope it's real soon. I'm sort of tired of this place. It's getting worse and worse and worse. But we're going home. Mike was not home here. He knew where his home was. Let's pray. Father, I pray the words that have been shared by our fellow pastors, fellow people of God that love Mike Lane. I mean, if I had my way, this wouldn't have happened. But you said, precious in the sight of the Lord are the death of his saints. And I pray for the family, for Christy and Brandon and Debbie and all the family and loved ones. What a great legacy and memory. What a blessing it is for me to be able to spend a few years with Brother Mike. I'll always remember him. But I thank God for the olive leaf today, and that's why we're here. And I pray for all of the people that took their time to come to this memorial service to honor this man of God. I love you, Lord, with all my heart. And I thank you that my path was able to cross paths with a man like Mike Lane and Debbie. And I love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's all stand and sing this song together. It is well with my soul. See, when peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught
so it is well.
Fitting question. I think Mike would sure want us to ask this question as we conclude this service. Is it well with your soul? Do you know Christ as your only hope, your only Lord, your only Savior? If you don't, what a beautiful thing it would be to end this service today with you accepting Christ as your only hope. We're going to have our funeral officials come at this time. They're going to escort our family out first. So let's stand in honor of them as they come. Once again, on behalf of the family, thank you so much for coming out today. I know it's been a blessing to them, and they're gathered out in the foyer for you to be able to just share a word of encouragement with. Thank you so much. You're dismissed.